Welcome to Life Church Panania. And although it is the depths of winter, the flock is still gathering, albeit online, and you are welcome. Thank you for joining with us. We're your shepherd and shepherdess for today. I am Ian.
And I'm Eleanor.
Now, just a heads up, we're going to be celebrating communion today. So if you need to pause while you prepare your bread and wine, that's fine. We'll be here when you come back. Assuming you are back or still here, we're going to move on to the theme that we have through today's service is the fact that God is our Father and loves us and we are His children and we're in that relationship. It is such a good thing to be a child of God. So let's commence our time with prayer. Father, thank you that we can call you Father. Abba Father, close Father, the one who loves us and cares for us and does the very best he can for us. Oh, forgive us for the times when we've been foolish enough to think that we could do without you. Thank you that you win us back. Thank you that you continue to love us. Thank you for your grace and your mercy that you just lavish on us day after day. Open our eyes that we can see you. Open our hearts that we can know you. Open our voices that we can praise you. Open our courage that we might speak for you. Thank you for all you've done for us. Now equip us through this service that we might be better prepared to live it out what it means to be a child of God. And this we do through your Son's name, Jesus. Amen. We've got some great songs together, and this is a fabulous little one to start with. Here we are together again praising the Lord, so let's sing it. Sing it out loud. We are praising the Lord. Indeed, we praise him. Another great little song that we've recently added to our repertoire is the doxology. So let's praise God through this as well.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above ye, heavenly host, praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen, 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 amen. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures below. Praise him above ye, heavenly host, praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen, 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 amen.
Our theme is God the Father. So let's celebrate that. This is a great song to remind ourselves of all that we are, all that He is, and the wonder of what it is to be His. Let's sing, Father God, I wonder. Now, no need to wonder what the announcements are, because they are indeed a couple of things. First of all, tomorrow, Monday evening, we're going to have our prayer time, our monthly hour of power. But what's different this time is that during winter, and it is winter now, we're going to be praying online. So if you email me, I will know that you want to be connected, and we will get together online and pray together from tomorrow evening at 7 o'clock. I hope that you'll explore that. Now, this is just an experiment, but you're welcome to be part of that experiment. That's Monday. And then on Wednesday, I'm sure that the snow won't be terribly deep at Picnic Point, and so we will get physically together for our Go Deeper question and answer segment. This is a great time that we have. So if you can be there, then you'll be most welcome as well. And now that brings us to a time when we gather around the Lord's table. We always make this the centerpiece of our service, because the death and resurrection of Christ is a center point of our spiritual life. So we come to, you know, the Lord's table to use these simple elements. We read, Jesus took bread, he gave thanks and broke it and gave it to them, saying, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. So for whatever you're using as your bread, take it and let me give thanks. Heavenly Father, thank you for this simple reminder that Jesus came to be one of us. He took on flesh and blood that he could die for us to pay our penalty. The wages of our sin became his death. Thank you that you give us eternal life through him. And we celebrate that through his broken body, this broken bread. And we do so in his precious name. Amen. Now, take your bread, break it, eat it, and give thanks as you remember him. Jesus then took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." Wonder of the new covenant, a new way of relating. And now it's no longer by animal sacrifice, but by what Jesus did at Calvary for us. So take your cup, drink it, giving thanks for the one who said, "Do this to remember me." Heavenly Father, thank you for the wonder of our Saviour. Thank you for your plan from eternity that reached out to us to save us from our sin, to save us from ourselves, to save us from the world, and make us your very own. Thank you for Jesus. Oh, and may we live his life as it's been poured out for us. Now may it be poured into us, that we live and breathe for you. Thank you for our Saviour. We give you our praise in Jesus' own name. Amen. Part of saying thank you to God is our obedience through taking the Lord's Supper. Part of it is through celebrating in song and in worship. Part of it is through what we're able to give back to God to extend his earthly realm. And we do this through our giving. Thank you for all of you who choose to participate. If you haven't, would you consider jotting down these numbers and actually being part, not just enjoying the music and learning from the message, but rather being a contributor as well? You don't have to, but the opportunity is there. God will bless you either way. Thank you for your participation. And now we're continuing the theme that God is our Father and he loves us. So let's sing together how deep the Father's love for us. the song is called Spirit Song, but it really is focusing on Jesus, for the Holy Spirit forms Christ within us. So let's sing together this beautiful song, the Spirit Song. Now, continuing our Father theme, Jesus prayed to Abba Father, and we can do so ourselves, and we're going to sing those words. Let's sing together, Abba Father.
Son called out to me, I was lost. For years my cradle swung above the grave. It is a wondrous thing to be adopted by a king, to know a love that crowns and crucifies. Spirit moves, I breathe a prayer to you. I cry not from my mouth, but from the heart. Because the Spirit came, I can use your holy name, the tender name a child could only use. Abba, adopted.
teaching me to give, teaching me to live, to show the family likeness of your love. So Jesus has become for me a brother, Lord, a special son who died to set us free. His cross for me has won the right to be your child, a special child you'll never cast aside. Abba Father, Abba Father, since that word became your covenant name, Abba Father, I cry out to you, knowing you will hear my plea, for you've adopted me.
God's word is always important. We build our services around the sequential exposition of God's word. And so that brings us to our text for today. Our reading comes from Galatians chapter 4, verses 1 through 7.
Hear the word of the Lord. What I am saying is that as long as the heir is a child, he is no different from a slave, even though he is the owner of everything. He is subject to guardians and trustees until the date set by his father. So also, when we were children, we were enslaved under the basic principles of the world. But when the time had fully come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those under the law, that we might receive our adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying out, Abba, Father! So you are no longer a slave, but a son. And since you are a son, you are also an heir through God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. When you look in the mirror, who do you see? What do you see? I hope you see something that God sees. So let's probe that a little further. Now, you can see from your outline that there's three things that we're going to tune into. And the first of them is looking back over my life. Looking backwards is actually not a bad thing to do from time to time. Our text gives us a time frame in the opening couple of verses. As long as this was the case, up until this particular date. So let's explore that just a little bit before we go deep into our text. So looking back over your life, you can feel or seem or observe things that are mostly negative or mostly positive. Which would they be for you? Has your life been more positive or more negative? I hope it's been relatively positive, but you've got some of both, haven't you? And the way you think and the way you feel about what's happened actually makes a huge difference here and now. So, for example, if you've got negative thoughts, if you've had negative experiences, then there's bound to be anger and fear, and that will keep on looping until you do something about that. And the thing that to do is to add thanksgiving to your life. Look back over your life. Don't pretend the bad didn't happen. It did. But recognize the thanksgiving. Thank God that it wasn't worse. Thank God that he got you through that. Thank God that you're here now. There's a lot of positive, and by adding thanks, it helps you to be above and beyond the reach of the past. Thanksgiving is one of the best things you can do to have a positive life here and now. So let's explore that just a little bit deeper. What does looking back over my life do? First of all, it will change my mood here and now. Looking back is often triggered by negative emotions like loneliness or sadness. But there's studies have been done where people have been forced to remember the past, you know, like writing out something, an event that made them angry or fearful. And when they did that, the participants reported that they usually felt depressed. But when the participants included gratitude or thanksgiving into those events, their thanks freed them from the event and lifted them above their depression. You can change your mood as you look back. Looking back is often triggered by asking, what have I done with my life? Now, in a world where we're surrounded by stories of superheroes, it would be easy to think that we haven't measured up. But God didn't call you to be a superhero. He called you to walk with a supernatural Savior. And you are here now, you're listening and watching this, because you have overcome difficulties. You have triumphed over adversity. You have come through grief and loss, because you are more than conqueror. Don't make the mistake of measuring yourself against an imaginary superhero. Declare your true worth. You are so valuable that Jesus died for you. You are so precious that Jesus wants to spend eternity with you. That is what gives your life meaning. Looking back can also improve your physical condition right now. So, in one series of studies, participants felt warm and fuzzy after they were listening to the music of their youth. In another study, the participants were able to plunk their hands into freezing ice water and do a task, and they could do it by remembering something positive from the past. So remembering a blast from the past really does make you feel warm and fuzzy right now. So if you're feeling cold, pull out the photo albums and celebrate what God has been doing in your life. And looking back can give optimism for your future. It seems counterintuitive, but a healthy looking back enables you to look forward with optimism. It's also important to create new memories and to remember today. Look, however bland and ordinary today might seem, this is the source of nostalgia for your future. Make the most of every day while you've got it, because it will be beneficial on into the future. So remember how looking back can be good for you, or like adding thanks makes every day good for you. Or you can get caught in this negative loop. Don't stay there. Move forward with thanksgiving. And while looking back is good for you, don't stay there. Look back, glance back, give thanks for where you've come from and what you've come through, but keep moving forward. Now, let's that's all background stuff. That's interesting. But let's come into our text itself in Galatians chapter 4. So, what does my past tell me? It tells me I actually had nothing of real value. What I'm saying is, as long as the heir is a child, he is no different from a slave. Verse 2, he is a subject to guardians and trustees. Like it or not, we are all slaves. There are things that we are required to do. We're slaves to those in authority. We have to obey the rules of the road when we're driving. We are slaves to our own bodies. We have to eat. We have to sleep. We're slaves to 1,000 things, including slaves to sin. Now, we know the law is spiritual, but I am unspiritual, sold as a slave to sin. I don't really understand myself, for I want to do what's right, but I don't do it. Instead, I do what I hate. What a way to live. There's got to be something better than that. So while I actually had nothing of value in my past, I potentially had everything. So while I was no different from a slave, I was the owner of everything. And that comes to fruition when I come to Christ. Let me show you something really interesting. I only just came to this realization myself this week. Ephesians chapter 1. Who doesn't love the opening verses of Ephesians chapter 1? But the whole chapter, let me give you the overview, because it falls into two halves. And they are just so interesting. Now, the chapter opens up with words like, God the Father has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the realms of heaven. How good is that? Now, the next few verses go on and they unpack that for us. So what are these blessings that we have received? We are God's elect. He's chosen us. We're holy. We're blameless. We're predestined. We're adopted. We're redeemed. We're forgiven. We're given grace. We're given knowledge. We are in Christ. That's every spiritual blessing and more that we could possibly want. How good is that? But it's not the whole story. It's only half of the story. When you come into the second half of the chapter, it says, I've not stopped giving thanks. Well, here's thanksgiving again. I've not stopped giving thanks and praying that the glorious Father may give to you. Now, hang on. If we've already got every spiritual blessing, what more could we add? So, now, that's not a rhetorical question. It's a real one. Answer that. What more could God possibly give you if he's already given you every spiritual blessing? He could give you suggestions. Well, the passage goes on to tell us. He wants to give you wisdom and revelation and knowledge and enlightenment and understanding and to know Christ not just as your Savior, but resurrected, glorified, and all of that glory living within you. So it's not an additional blessing, but rather it's an awareness of all the blessings you've got and the wisdom to be able to draw on those and use them every single day. So, looking back over my life, looking back over your life, have you been aware of all of the blessings that you've been given? Have you been using those? Well, if not, then today is a good time to start living out what it means to be God's special friend. So that's the first thing, looking back over my life. You know, we're going to pick up the pace a little now. And this is a great cue for looking down on my life, for seeing my life from above. Now, you know, you've been in this place. There are times when you're in a situation where all you can see around you is trees, trees, trees. No matter which way you look, there's a tree in the way. No matter where you step, you bang into a tree. They're just everywhere. How do you get out of a situation like this? What you really need is to step above the trees and look down on the forest to get to a place where you can see the broader landscape, where you can look and see the horizon way off in the distance. You need a bigger perspective to look down on your life from above. The best view is the highest view, the view from heaven's perspective, to see things from God's point of view, and there is nothing better than that. So our text goes on to say that I am part of God's program. Verse 4 tells us, when the time had fully come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law. When it finally stops being all about me at last it becomes all about God and what he's doing, and we step into his program instead of trying to squeeze him into our program. So when the time had fully come, this is a special interest to me, so I have to share it with you, but I'll try and be really brief about it. This is the last step in the Old Testament's continuous stream of dates. There is a date all the way from creation through to Christ, and this is the last one. Daniel was told 70 blocks of 7 years are going to go from you, Daniel, through to the Anointed One, the Messiah, the Savior. And so I pulled out my calculator earlier. 70 blocks of 7 years is 490 years. So nearly 5 centuries before Jesus came. Daniel's told, this is the program that God has got. So it was going to be, first of all, a block of 7 years. 7 times 7 is 49 years. And this is the people coming out of exile from Babylon, rebuilding the temple, rebuilding their city. And then the next 62 blocks of seven, I needed the calculator for this one, that's 434 years, was a time when the Persian Empire was overthrown by Alexander the Great. The Greek Empire that he established dissolved into its constituent parts. And then the Roman Empire rose, and they were the ones still in charge right through the life of Christ. And here, when the time had fully come, it's that final block of 7 years after the 62, that last one, the Anointed One, which is, of course, Christ, will be cut off. He'll be killed. He'll have nothing. And what will he do? He'll confirm a covenant with many in that 1-7, in the middle of the seven, you know, after half of seven, 3.5. He had 3.5 years of ministry, and he put an end to sacrifice and the offerings of the temple. No other sacrifice is legitimate now because Jesus has died. He is the last sacrifice. And we remember that around the Lord's table, where we read that Jesus gave his blood as the new covenant in his shed blood. And so from when Daniel was told in 457 BC through to when Jesus died in the middle of the final seven, God has been at work and has set forth his program. But we can go back even further than that. Let's go back to before even the Garden of Eden. The Father chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world. That's how long God's program has been operating. From eternity past, he knew about you, and he wanted you to be part of his program so that you could be holy and blameless in his presence for all eternity future. How good it is to be connected into God through Jesus Christ. So not only am I part of God's program, I'm also part of God's privileges. So why did Jesus come? God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to have two things: to redeem us from under the penalty of the law, so that we can also receive our adoption to be part of God's family. So first of all, God redeems us. He releases us from the guilt of the past. This is what he takes from me, my guilt, my sin, my penalty. And then I receive from him the adoption into his family that gives me the future that I need. And so we're looking forward to Jesus coming back again. He said, I'm going to prepare a place for you, and I will come back and receive you unto myself. First, we receive from him, and then we are received by him. There's one more thing. We quickly need to move ahead. I'm looking forward into my future. And there are two things I now choose to live by my divine relationships. We are God's family. We are God's children. We cry out to him. Abba, Father, I'm told, is like Daddy, Father. It's a close personal relationship. That's how Jesus lived. Even in the Garden of Gethsemane, when he was about to die, he said, Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. And that's what we cry out as well. All who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. You didn't receive a spirit of slavery that takes you back into that fear, anger, negative loop, but you received the spirit of a legitimate family by whom we cry, Abba, Father. We are indeed God's children. And that leads me to live by my divine responsibilities. Because I've got a divine relationship, it gives me divine responsibilities. We're a child. We are an heir. We are able to receive all of those blessings from Ephesians chapter 1 and more besides. We've got every spiritual blessing. So now what's my responsibility? What do I do with all those blessings? Well, whatever it is that you do, do it all for the glory of God. That's what it comes down to. It's not about a set of rules. It's about being you, knowing that you're blessed and giving glory back to God by everything that you do. It's not about rules and tasks. It's about relationships and celebration. So when you look at yourself, who do you see? I hope you see someone that God loves to celebrate. And now our song of response, because we're in God's family, we're going to celebrate that through this song. Let's sing together. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord.
Harmony and love.
at my house. We will serve the Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. We will serve the Lord. We will serve the Lord.
Make that an amen. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord, and I pray that will be your prayer and commitment as well. Thank you for being part of our service today. Let me close in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for all that you've done for us. Thank you that you are our Father, that you love us, that you're generous and kind, and you give us so much, even what we don't deserve, but you give us so much that is so good. We want to be followers of Jesus and help others to follow him as well. And now may the Lord bless you, keep you, make his face shine on you, be gracious to you, and give you peace with him and peace in this world. In Jesus' name, amen. Only one more thing left to do, or two more things. The first of them is to let someone know that you went to church online and how much you enjoyed it. And then the other thing is, let's now have a nice cup of tea. So, until next time, God bless.